will look scared to death. And I can't understand that, because the time to be scared would have been the first day of admissions, right? Not now. The welcoming opening remarks. Unfortunately, due to Mother Nature and Father Time, that's not going to happen. Mother Nature, because right now our president, President Tate, is in Boston babysitting 22 inches of snow. So she's not going anywhere. Father Time, because we're not going to hold up the ceremony for her, even though we'll miss her, right? Okay. So welcome, graduates, faculty, family, friends, alumni, guests, to our graduation. I'd like to open this ceremony with a quote from Eleanor Roosevelt, who said, "I gain strength, courage, confidence by every experience in which I must look fear in the eye. And I say to myself, I lived through this, and I can live through anything that comes along after this. We must learn to do the things we think we cannot." So I ask you a simple question, like, what is fear? What's fear? Well, one thing for certain, we know that there are different types of fear, and clearly fear is relative to the individual. So, for some, fear may be the apprehensiveness of approaching a dog because, after all, you don't know what's going on in that dog's head and he might bite. For others, it's fear of flying because you can't control that airplane. But let me tell you something. The greatest fear that exists to me, besides being a passenger in the car with our president, Florence Tate, because she has a lead foot and I'm not in control of that, but the greatest fear is fear of the consequence that will arise when you fail to complete a project or a task that fell solely on your shoulders. That is fear. Today, 21 individuals have accomplished something that was far from easy. And yes, attached to this accomplishment was a certain amount of fear, believe you me, and they'll tell you if you haven't experienced it for yourselves. Fear of returning to the classroom. Fear of the ability to complete a project on time. That's my fear. So as Langston Hughes stated so poignantly, what happens to a dream deferred? Does it dry up like a raisin in the sun? Let me share a few statistics with you. The Washington Post, USA Today, and the New York Times have published numerous articles relative to the educational level of Americans today. And I want you to know that the Washington region is among the nation's most educated. 42% of adults in the region, in this region, hold at least one degree, a baccalaureate degree. And that's nice. But within the entire United States, I want you to know that only 24% of adults hold baccalaureate degrees. That's something. Among African Americans, it's only 14%. And among Hispanics, it's only 8%. Well, we're talking about a nation that is the most educated nation. However, these numbers reflect a lot of fear and in many, many cases, dreams deferred. Let's look at a moment at our population of students. The average age is 40, and yeah, a few of them are down here saying, but I'm not 40 years old yet, but I want you to know the vast majority of them are glad that I stopped at the age 40. They know the truth. Nonetheless, with age comes responsibility, mortgages, careers, children. So many of us had to defer our dreams because of our responsibilities. But what makes our graduates different? I don't have all the answers, I'm going to tell you that now, but I do have my theory relative to their success. First of all, age and experience. Learning how to organize your lives and incorporating your life's experiences into the classroom setting, the big thing. The second thing, intestinal fortitude. I will no longer be fearful. I can do this. I will do this. And the third thing, sheer cantankerousness. My dad used to say to me that you can put off a difficult task to the point where just the evil in you drives you forth. And I want you to know, for some of these graduates, I would imagine, and they're laughing down there, they know which ones they are, drove them forth. Now, I'm sure everyone's heard the expression, nothing worth having comes easy. As well, what doesn't kill you will make you strong. Well, I'm going to share with you the one thing that many of them have said is going to kill me, but it didn't. And I bet you they know what it is, too.
Capstone.
I hear Capstone, I hear ARP running neck and neck. Well, yes, it's the Applied Research Project, ladies and gentlemen, and that's the cornerstone of the educational process at this institution. Applied Research Project, affectionately known as the ARP. Well, let me tell you something. Since my tenure at Potomac College, I've heard the Applied Research Project, the ARP, renamed a couple of things. And I'm going to share just a few of them with you. ARP stands for a real pain. ARP stands for a real academic pistol. ARP stands for academically ruthless process. These are from the students. And then there's a fourth one here, but I don't think it's appropriate to share with you because it deals with some bodily function. But what makes it so difficult? Well, we at Potomac College have a level of excellence that we expect each of the students to achieve. We don't give them their grades, they earn their grades. And believe me, they have earned these grades. Each student must formulate, conceptualize, hypothesize a statement of a problem, conduct academic research to support or refute the hypothesis, provide background information relative to their organization, indicate how the proposed changes will impact the organization, estimate the cost and time frame that it will take to incorporate the changes, and then combine all of the above to create a tangible product that follows the guidelines of the publication manual of the American Psychological Association. Now, if you think that was a mouthful to listen to, imagine how they felt having to do it. All right? That's an accomplishment. Now, the above process must be complete within a six-week time frame. Most students sitting before you had to complete 10 of these, plus a capstone project. The average number of pages for each ARP, 30. This is not an easy program. Now, you could say that this program makes you cantankerous, because it did. And you could say that it creates a certain level of fear and anxiety, because it did. But I want you to know that the process did not deter any of these graduates from their dream. And that's what's most important. Now, this is the point where I get to say, I told you so. I told you so because somewhere during the program, somewhere during the process, I hear this. If I ever get through this program, I'm never going back to school. Or, I cannot believe I paid someone to put me through this. But they did. But here's where I say I told you so. Because of the 21 students who sit before you this afternoon, 13 of them to date have requested that I send a copy of their transcript to graduate schools. Now that is the Potomac difference. That's what we are proud of. And the best thing of all is these students know that the key to success is commitment to continuous personal improvement. That and nothing more. And on that note, I want to close this welcoming with one final quote from Eleanor Roosevelt, who said, "The future belongs to those who believe in the beauty of their dreams." Thank you.
When I first came to come to college 7.5 years ago, I did not have to use these. Part of my reason for using green ink, I can read it better than red ink. It's just, it also gives you something to remember. Somebody asked me today, would you please retire the pen? I may just do that. You know, folks, you've heard a lot about the applied research projects today. One of the things is, people often think of a college degree as a means for an individual to advance their career or to enhance their own business. Well, in most cases, this happens only after they graduate. At Potomac College, through the use of the applied research projects, our students get to practice this well before they finish their program. The faculty would like to recognize four of our students today for the Founders Award. Let me read to you what the Founders Award says. This award reflects the vision of the college founder in establishing Bachelor of Science programs that integrate academic study with course-related projects completed at the student's workplace. It is awarded to students who have made the most outstanding contribution to the workplace through the Applied Research Project and Capstone Project as part of his or her Potomac College degree program. While we are recognizing four students today, I think I can honestly say that we have 21 students here who have made quite significant contributions to their workplaces through their capstones and, prior to that, their many ARPs. Please keep those with you. They always serve as a good portfolio if you wish to take your careers to another level. This is always a difficult award for the faculty to do because we can only give a few of these, and it's an interesting discussion, and we are always trying to say, okay, what are we looking at and the achievements. Four that I'd like to present today that the faculty voted on. Our first recipient owns his own music production company. When I met with him to discuss an ARP for his first class, he had no idea where to start. So we put first things first, and he began to work on a business plan. From that point, he went on to work on many other projects, one setting forth financial projections, one that conducted analysis of a group decision support system, one that analyzed the correlation between advertising expenses and revenues, and on and on. Ultimately, every ARP and his capstone project provided the building blocks to a much stronger enterprise. Now he has the tools to march forward with his company and become a major player in the music production industry. It is my pleasure to present one of our Founders Awards to Abraham Afewerki.
Just a lot of work. This is just you.
We always like to take a little bit more time to highlight these awards for the Founders Award because this is such the cornerstone of what our college is all about. Our second recipient works for a major healthcare cost management company. Their role is to be a link between the insurance companies and professional medical providers. With her Capstone project, she created a presentation to help her company.
On behalf of the faculty who has voted their approval, I present to you the candidates who have fulfilled all requirements for the degree of Bachelor of Science in Information Systems Management. Will the candidates for this degree please step forward to receive your degree as your name is called? With honors, Abraham Afewerki. By the authority of the District of Columbia, which has been vested in me by the Board of Trustees, I confer upon each of you the degree of Bachelor of Science with all its rights, privileges, and responsibilities. Thank you.
I want it all. No time for less. I've laid the plans. Now you have the chance right here in your hand. Cause you need one moment in time when you're more than you thought you could be. Wisdom
is a never-ending cycle of blending knowledge with life experiences and lessons learned that are not soon forgotten. Ultimately, these things are the tools and materials we use to build our futures. Based on the values and integrity that have been instilled in us by our parents, teachers, and given the proper direction, we draw on these raw materials to develop a foundation, a building block of our lives, and build on our character. Hi, Mom. The future decisions we make will be decided by the lessons of trial and error, advice and actions of our mentors, and by the foundations that we stand on. I began my college career on three principles that I think apply to all of us. First is faith. For many of us took a leap of faith to undertake the daunting task of completing or furthering our education. Those of who have families, jobs, or a myriad of other circumstances took on the challenge undeterred and met it head on despite the unknown. Second is hope. The hope that we might make our families proud and that we would succeed and live up to our greatest potential and expectation. Third and last, and the greatest of all, is love. The love that our families and friends, the freedom that we have to learn about what we are most passionate about, and the love of what we do. School has been fun, and often it has not been easy, because it has been a pursuit of knowledge that one day is sure to become wisdom. In the words of Frederick Douglass, without struggle, there is no progress. We, the class of 2003, truly understand the meaning of the phrase. We have been challenged academically, physically, and financially. Some time ago, we committed ourselves to forfeiture of summers, spring breaks, sleep, and sometimes our sanity to immerse ourselves in a year-round comprehensive education program. We saw an opportunity to develop our skills, jump ahead of the competition, and earn a degree that can perpetuate our careers that we are most passionate about. And today is the culmination of that tremendous accomplishment. Potomac College has made us part of an elite team who has been given an opportunity to positively influence our communities and our industries with the knowledge and experience we've gained here. To be part of this team has been an honor, and our success is a reflection of the dedication, encouragement, and support from a group of faculty, staff, peers, and our family. And for that, I thank you and wish you all the best. Of good luck. God bless. Comes from Cohort 48. As you see, it's got the Navy anchor. And there was a lot of discussion from my Marine friends and my Navy friends. And I didn't know that there was really that much difference between them, but there is. So what we've come up with was to give a bell to Potomac College and to start a new tradition. One bell, one ring, signaling that we're entering the program, and two bells means we get it now.
Even though it maybe two bells symbolizes getting out of Attica the way you did. The thought is fabulous, and yes, this will be a new tradition for Potomac College. On behalf of the faculty and staff, thank you. And our closing remarks, we will provide our closing remarks. On behalf of faculty and staff, Potomac College, will be Professor Carol Edwards. And again, I thank you.
This is such a thrilling time. I'm so excited. I don't know what to do with myself. And I'm not even graduating today, but praise the Lord. On behalf of the faculty and staff of Potomac College, we just like to congratulate you again. We know that you could not have done this without your families and your friends and the prayers from your churches. I've heard all of that before, but that's what I'm saying. How many know where promotion comes from? Thank you. Thank you. So, promotion comes from the Lord, doesn't it? Psalm 75:6 says that it comes from the Lord, not from the north, the south, the east, or the west. Everybody's had a part to play in this wonderful occasion, but he deserves a praise. Let's give God a praise. The Lord reminded me that, you know, this day was preordained before the foundation of the world. You were particularly selected for this time, a moment in time, as my brother just sang about. I would like to say that when you are promoted, your family is promoted, Potomac College is promoted. Everybody goes to another level. Isn't that beautiful? What I want you to do is walk in this wonderful newness that you're in. Walk in it and represent well, all right? Let's give the Lord one more hand for this wonderful time. Now, there are a few housekeeping rules we need to take care of right now. The graduates will be leaving first. You are to remain family and friends. I know you're excited, but you need to remain here until the graduates come back. They have to go out and take a photograph. So everybody would call great, greatly appreciate it. Thank you again, and God bless you. Bye-bye.
French steps.
How about it?
He's still there. Everybody else?
Oh, yeah.
Everybody else is going.
Oh, yes. Yes.
Exactly.
Yep, that's there how it
go. Goes. Would you like my seat?
There you go.
You must go.